Look at Matthew chapter 5, verse 14. Matthew chapter 5, verse 14. Lord began to speak at the end of last year that our theme for the church would be lighted up. That's the name of the church that I pastor. The theme of the church would be lighted up for 2017. It's a very catered message. It's a very catered word. I think it has broader ramifications. And I believe this is what I'm supposed to challenge you with on today. That you got to light it up. He says in Matthew chapter 5, verse 14, you are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. Please understand that from a syntax perspective, from the construct of the sentence, from a grammatical approach, he moves from the singular to the plural. He's speaking to them and he says, you are the light of the world. You are the light of the world. You are the light of the world. You're the light of the world. Those are individual, personalized comments. But then he says, you're a city set on a hill. When was the last time you saw a city that only had one light in it? I'm already preaching. Y'all can help me sit down quick if y'all said amen. Amen. When it get quiet, I get longer because I feel like I got to explain what I just said. He starts off making identificational statements. You are the light and you are a city. He says that you got to check your light. You got to get your light right first. So that the city will be well lit. This brother right here said, that's good. That's good. If I'm not burning, we ain't seeing. I was recently on a plane and we were coming home in the evening. And so the sun had set and the captain came on. Before the captain had not come on the intercom yet. And so I'm looking out the window. I'm looking past my wife. She's sitting next to me. I'm on the aisle seat. They let the little window up. And I'm looking outside the window. And I'm looking. And I'm starting to see some flickering. And I keep looking. And I said, okay, that's it. That's it. Captain should be coming on now. That's the ATL shouting. That's it right there. We almost home. We almost home. As far up as I was, without anybody saying anything, I could see my city because of how many lights were illuminating. It's that kind of picture that Matthew 5, 14 is describing. He's saying the way that folk will know that you are a part of the kingdom is not only how bright your light shines, but how bright your lights shine. The movie, Jason Bourne, Bourne Identity. What was the guy's name? Matt, was that Matt Damon? Oh, okay, all right, Matt Damon. Anybody see that movie? Anybody see that movie? Okay, all right, so for those who didn't raise their hands, real quick, Matt Damon, Jason Bourne, he's suffering from severe memory loss. He can't figure out where he's from. He don't know his parents. He don't know how he got where he is. He's suffering from severe memory loss. But while he's trying to figure out who he is, he keeps finding hints. But stuff is confusing him. You know, he's part of the CIA, so he's got a whole bunch of different passports. One passport says this name, next passport says this name, next passport is from this country, other passport, different name, a different country. He doesn't know who he is. And while he's trying to figure out who he is, the enemies are trying to kill him. Because they know who he is. They know that he's a highly trained, effective CIA agent that is lethal with his hands. And so before he can figure out who he is, they're trying to take him out because they don't want him to know. I'm preaching better than some of y'all are saying amen. In Matthew 5, Jesus is giving them an identity statement. He's talking to individuals and he says, you are the light, you are the light, you are the light. And then he moves to the collective and he says, you are the light. I just wonder if anybody's got any devils chasing you. Anybody got any issues? Anybody got a boss that seem like won't give you a break? Anybody got a spouse that get on your nerves? Anybody got some kids that you just, you know, shut your mind down? Anybody got any problems? Your money look funny? You don't know how you're going to pay the rent more days than dollars? Anybody got some enemies chasing you? Here's the point. If you know who you are, if you come into agreement that God made me like this, this is just who I am. If you come to know who you are, that's why the enemy is working so hard. That's why he's trying to take you out. That's why he keeps pulling these little tricks on you. You get the alternator fixed, and then the air conditioner go out. You know, it's been hot. It's been a hot winter. We've been blowing air, this winter. And then you get the air fixed. Now you need some heat. And the heat in the house, the furnace won't work. And then you didn't know the bill was going to be that high. Y'all understand what I'm saying? The enemy is trying to take you out because he doesn't want you to know who you are and how God has made you. So he starts with this simple statement, this identity statement, and he says, you are the light. In an individual identifying way, and then he moves to, you are the light. But I got my whole sermon, all alliterated. I can't give y'all all the points, but let me just show you this one thing. When it comes down to light, it's about presentation. Let the church say presentation. Mm-hmm. When it comes about the light, it's about presentation. I'm in Matthew chapter 5, verse number 14. He says, you are the light of the world. A city is set on a hill, cannot be hidden, nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket. Did I read too fast? Y'all with me? Okay, so once you get lit, don't go hide yourself. See, I know what the problem is. Some of y'all think about the other kind of lit. I got some college students here. I know that. So some of y'all think about the other kind of lit. I'm talking about like burning with light. Once you get lit, don't go hide yourself. Verse 15, nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. That's important. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Y'all still with me, class? All right, look at what, this is going to be hard. This might be hard. This might turn a few folk off. This might be hard. Look at what the light had to do. The light's responsibility was just to burn. Y'all wait for me to tell you the rest? That's all of it. All the light had to do, just burn. I feel here usher speaking to me. Let it burn, let it burn. Brother, you do a whole better job on that one than me. All the light had to do was just burn. He just had to be. He just had to sit up there and just flicker. He didn't have to work at it. All he had to do was flicker. Okay, all right, all right. So the context, you thinking about your 2,500 square foot house, your 1,800 square foot house, your 4,300 square foot house, whatever it might be. You thinking about how many lights you got in your house. All right. Culturally speaking, don't think house like in the city of Macon. Think dorm room. Y'all know little dorm rooms. You can get 1.5 beds in there. They got that little tiny space they call a closet. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Just small. Those are what the houses look that size. In these houses, there would be a ledge built in, architecturally speaking, in the wall. And that was the place that the lampstand, that the light would sit on. And so if the house was to have light, it would have to sit up on the shelf, up on the wall. Look, I'm going to give you all these few things and I'm done. Watch this. Somebody had to pick the light up. Y'all missed it. You missed it. The light didn't get lit and then go climb up and sit up on the wall and say, okay, let me work my way on up here. I see my place where I'm supposed to be. Let me climb up here and get on top of this. Oh, I'm almost there. Oh, I slipped off. Oh, now I'm up here. Somebody had to come and take the light and put it up there. Can I prophesy to somebody that God wants to pick you up and put you where he wants you to be, on the right shelf, in the right house, that you ain't got to do. You ain't got to kiss behind. You don't have to brown nose. You don't have to cheat. You don't have to steal. But if you just burn, your responsibility is just stay lit and watch and let God come and pick you up. Do I have a witness in here that God will pick you up and put you where he wants you to be? Not only does somebody have to come pick the light up, somebody has to put the light in the right place. Architecturally speaking, there was a piece of something that came out the wall that was the shelf. That the only something that could sit up there wasn't the picture frame. Wasn't one of them little globes, you know, with the snow in it. You shake it up, you turn around. That didn't go up there. Yeah. You didn't put no cable box up there. No Wi-Fi. Your modem wasn't up there. Yeah. That space was for light and light only. God has a exact place. He has an exact place that he's trying to put you, but you keep fighting against it. You keep wanting him to do it on your time. You keep wanting him to do it your way. You keep trying to choose the field and your profession. And that's why some of you all are frustrated right now in your profession, that there is no joy because you picked it. God didn't put you there. You picked it for the salary when God is saying, no, I got more for you to do somewhere else. Here's the next thing. Here's the next thing about that light. Somebody had to set it on fire. Ooh, you know, my mother taught me when I was young, don't talk with your mouth full. It, pastor invited y'all to eat. He told you get your spoons, get your plates out. I guess y'all just eating and y'all ain't talking because your mouth is full. Look, somebody had to pick it up. Somebody had to put it in the right place. Somebody had to set it on fire. Talk to me, mother. Talk, somebody. Look, verse 15. I want to look at verse 15. I want you to understand, though, it's counterintuitive to be on fire and then hit away. I think I will. It's counterintuitive to be on fire and then hit away. All right, I'm in verse 15. All right. Nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand. When it's put in the right place by somebody else, it blesses everybody in the house. I'm in verse 15 still. It says, but they get put on a lampstand and it gives light to all who are in the house. Can I just say something here? If you're not blessing your own house, you ain't gonna light up mine. Oh, I found out where the spiritual folk are. You know, you know, you on fire for Jesus, but your kids don't like you. Your husband ain't had no cooked meal. We got babies here. But you know, you hadn't serviced your house. He told me to preach like I was at home. I almost did right there. You always at the church. Wherever Pastor Nee, he ain't your husband. You gotta shine in your own house. Unless the ladies know that I'm an equal opportunity butt kicker, bruh, you shouldn't compliment somebody else, another lady, more than you compliment your wife. You gotta be a blessing to your own house. Elbow your neighbor and say, bless your house, bless your house. I'm finished. If folks start putting as much attention on their insides as they do on their outside, you'd be an amazing city. Ladies are always talking about that my face is beat. That sounds like domestic abuse to me. I thought you weren't supposed to, y'all know what I'm talking about, a beat face. You know, you slaying. I think that's what the lady's saying. You know, you wearing eyelashes. You know, eyelashes. We know them ain't your eyelashes. Look like Snuffleupagus. Y'all remember Mr. Snuffleupagus? Remember on Sesame Street, the elephant? Remember Mr. Snuffleupagus? She had them big eyes, them eyelashes. When they blink, you feel the wind, you feel the breeze. If you quit working on your outside and start working on your inside, Lord have mercy, you would be a blessing to your own house. Elbow the other neighbor, say, he is preaching to you. He is preaching to you. But no, reality TV got us messed up. We think Real Housewives of Atlanta is real. Basketball Wives. Now they got a new show, WAGs, Wives and Girlfriends of Athletes. And you got all these beautiful women on the inside, but when they open their mouth, and now we conform ourselves to what we see. Ladies, you know I'm right. You know, bro, it ain't all about a six pack. I got a six pack. It's somewhere in there. ain't never seen it, but I got one. I'm talking about me. I'm just talking about what I'm talking about. But nobody's going to love Alicia more than I love her. Nobody's going to be a better dad to Jordan or Naquad. Nobody's going to talk about me and my lack of integrity. I just ain't got 4 hours to spend in the gym every single day, 8 days a week. Y'all caught it, didn't you? You got to work on your inside. You got to light your own light so that your house will be blessed. I was struggling trying to figure out how we were going to close the sermon. Y'all still in Matthew 5, right? Okay, now we've just been hanging out in verses 14, 15, and 16. And we're talking about light. Maybe some of you inquisitive people, and I'm finished. I just want to read a few more verses. Maybe some of you inquisitive people are like, well, how do I make my light increase? That's what y'all were thinking, wasn't it? Wasn't it? That's what y'all were thinking. Right? You're lying. You weren't thinking that. How do I make my light shine more brightly? Okay. Matthew 5, 14 through 16. Jesus talking about being the light. He gives the identity statement. But it's interesting, he's just preached what's known as the Beatitudes. The Beatitudes are from verses 3 to 11. He says some more important stuff in verses 12 and 13, then he picks up on his light. But look, if we're going to preach the whole thing, we got to preach the whole thing. So if I'm going to be a light in verse 14, I got to understand how to burn. And he tells me how to burn in verses 3 through 11. I don't know what version y'all have, but I just want to read, and I'm finished. We're going to pray, and I'm finished. I'm going to read from the Message version. The Message version, I like the way Eugene Peterson writes it in verse 3. He says, you're blessed when you're at the end of your rope. Somebody just throw your hand up and say, I sure enough am blessed. With less of you, there is more of God and his rule. My God, when you're trying to pray up your next meal, when you don't have anybody else you can borrow, let me hold five. You know, when you look through the cushions on the couch and ain't no more change. But he says that you're blessed at the end of your rope with less of you, because then I got God and his rule. Somebody shout, I'm blessed. Verse 4, you're blessed when you feel you've lost what is most dear to you. Is there anybody here that's had some folk walk away from you? You lost some income. You lost some jobs. You lost, oh, come on here. You're blessed when you feel like you've lost everything that's dear to you. Only then can you be embraced by the one that is most dear to you. Somebody shout, I'm blessed.
I'm blessed.
Verse 5 says, you're blessed when you're content with just who you are. I better say that one again. You're blessed when you're content with just who you are. No more, no less. You ain't got to put weave in it. You don't need to put no silicone on it. You ain't got to put a girdle on it. You don't have to tie it in, sew it in, glue it in, tape it on. All right, y'all going to look at me like that? I got a church to pastor. I ain't scared of y'all. I ain't scared of none of you. If you got to put some Beijing in it or spray the can, you're blessed when you're just who you are. You got to like being you. I'm starting to get to the point that I like me. I like my wide shoulders. I like me. He says, you're blessed when you're content with who you are. That's the moment you find yourself proud owners of everything that can't be bought. There was a time when I was making a whole lot more money and had a whole lot of stuff, but I didn't have no peace. I didn't have any contentment. But then after I lost some stuff, after I got to the end and God's rule showed up, I realized just how blessed I was when I lost everything that I thought was important and realized I could be embraced by the one who is most important. Verse 6, I'm just reading. You're blessed when you've worked up a good appetite for God. He's food and drink in the best meal you'll ever eat. In verse 7, you're blessed when you care. At the moment of being careful, you find yourselves cared for. You're blessed when you get inside your world, your mind and your heart put right. Then you can see God in the outside world. You got to get your head right. You got to get your head right. You got to get your head right. Verse 9, you're blessed when you can show people how to cooperate instead of compete or fight. I'm just reading the word of God. That's when you discover who you really are and your place in God's family. You're blessed when your commitment to God provokes persecution. Some of us try to hide our love for God. Persecution drives you even deeper into God's kingdom. Last verse. Not only that, count yourselves blessed every time people put you down or throw you out or speak lies about you to discredit me. Jesus is speaking. What it means is that the truth is too close for comfort and they are uncomfortable. Pastor, I don't know, and whatever you all do, whatever, however you play, I'm finished. I just, may I pray for your people? Yeah. All right, okay. There's a very specific group of people that I'm talking about now. Very specific, and I just want you to stand where you are. I just want you to stand where you are, if this is you. But there was once a time when you felt like you were more on fire for God. You felt that your relationship was burning more brightly. But along the way, you've lost something. I'm not saying you in sin. I'm not saying you smoking weed or none of that kind of stuff. But I'm saying that the intimacy with God, it's not there like it once was. I'm talking to you. For all of us, if you want your light to shine more brightly, I just read you the recipe. Matthew 5, 3 through 11, that's your recipe. I've given you something to go back and check off. Am I inviting persecution? Am I standing up for what I believe? Am I, when they talk nasty jokes and bad jokes, hey, look, that's not me walking off. When I'm, oh, look, you henpeck, what? Call me whatever you want. That's fine. I just read to you the recipe of what it's like to be blessed. And all of us can stand to grow. The Bible says we grow from glory to glory and faith to faith, that we're moving it into different levels. But I'm specifically talking to those of you, and I want you just to stand right where you are, that there was once a time when you were closer to God. Yes, thank you, sister. Yes, yes, thank you. Than you are right now, that your fire was more bright. That your fire was more bright. God bless you. Yes, little lady. Yes, ma'am, I see you there. That your fire's more bright. Yeah, stand, if you would. If you got feet and they work, would you please stand? Yes, yes. If you can't stand, raise your hand. Brother, thank you. Thank you. Yes, yes. There was once a time. Yes, young lady. There was once a time when you were burning more brightly. You were burning more brightly. But you just lost a little something. Can I tell you that the enemy just don't come in and just kick you off the edge? What the enemy does is that he treats you like a boat that's not tied to dock. If you pull a boat next to the dock, it'll stay there for a minute. But the motion of the ocean will slowly let that boat drift off in the sea. That's what the enemy does. He puts your light out slowly. But you're coming home today. Do you hear me? You're coming home today. If you're standing next to, you're sitting next to somebody who is standing or has their hand raised, would you please just touch them in an appropriate way on their wrist, on their shoulders? Do not touch any other uncomfortable area on them. But if you're sitting next to someone or standing next to someone, brother, just reach out and touch her. The young lady is there. Just reach out and touch somebody. This lady has her hand up. This lady has her hand up. Just reach out. If you're sitting next to somebody, yeah, brother, I see you. I see you. You're sitting or standing? You're sitting next to someone who is standing or has their hand up. Father, right now in Jesus' name, we thank you, Lord. Yes, brother. Yes. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for what you've done in this place. Father, we claim right now that our lights would be relit. There would be a rekindling. The book of Revelation, chapter 2, I believe it is, he makes a very simple comment. He says, Return to your first love. That's your road back. That's your road to a brighter light. To return back to your first love. Go back to that season. To doing what you were doing. If you were standing on the streets preaching. If you were more on fire. If you were deliberate about sharing Jesus with somebody. If there was more time you spent in the Word of God. If there was more time you spent with the TV off. Go back to your first love. Y'all, I'm not telling you anything that's not in Scripture. I'm not lying to you. But God wants you to light it up. He wants this house to be a city that's set on a hill. It's coming. It's coming. It's coming. God is just trimming some wicks. He's not giving back up on you. And remember, you ain't got to do nothing. All you got to do is burn. Would you pray if you're standing, if you have your arms raised or your hand raised, would you just pray and say, Lord, just relight my fire. Just talk to the Lord. Just talk to the Lord. Lord, relight my fire. I miss you. I miss you. I hear the Lord saying, and I miss you too. I've been waiting for you to come back to me. Son, come home. I believe that was the lyrics that he spoke earlier. Son, daughter, come back home. Just ask the Lord, relight my fire. Relight my fire.
Come on, get a little hand clap of praise. Amen. Let me say this real quick. Let me say this because we're going to move. But let me say this out. After a word like that, here's what I always challenge us for, right? You can go to any church in this city and you can hear good preaching. But sometimes God sends you a rhema, which is a word from the Word. And I tell people all the time is this. I say, this is the challenge for me, Pastor William. Because in this, you have some awesome ministers in there, preachers in this area. You got Pastor Reginald Sharp right up the street. Awesome, phenomenal. Wordsmith. Pastor David Stanley. Awesome. But this is what I always judge by. Is our preaching really changing the world? I know John is going, what is he saying? Watch this. He had an invitation for if I'm on fire or not. And I'm not, you know that. I don't want to beat you up, but I really feel in my spirit. I have to challenge you a little bit because if you're really on fire, I always have to ask, when the last time you really won somebody to Christ? When the last time, if we so much on fire, why our graduation rates the way they are? Come on now, all these preachers, some got to be transferred. See, I'm on fire. Well, if you're on fire, then how's your house? If you're on fire, why are we still struggling with the same addictions over and over? See, we can sit cute and we can look, right? I'm on fire. Then if you're on fire, then you have to ask yourself, we have to ask ourselves these questions. Why is our economic city like this? Somewhere along the way, we have to stop, as he said earlier, just going and hearing great sermons. And this word had to get in me. And I had to come down and say, you know what, Lord? I need something. And I want the same old. It ain't got to be a hoop. It ain't got to be a holler. But guess what, God? I got to look around and really say, I got to really ask myself, what am I doing? I got to ask yourself, if we so much on fire, why is our city the way it is now? It's an indictment every Sunday for us to go talking about the preacher show preached in our city and our school system still the same way it is. You gotta ask, so somebody got somewhere we hear preaching, but ain't no transformation. Seed was sown today. Whether or not you receive the seed is a condition of our hearts. Stand to your feet.